Thank you very much, TJ and Admirable. Pascoa has officially booked his ticket to the America's Summer Championship, the first representative from Brazil and the second representative from Latin America in this very championship. In the past, we did have Snail in the winter and PNC in the spring. So let's take a minute to talk to Pascoa and see how he's doing. Pascoa, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Well, first of all, congratulations. You have officially made it to the America's Summer Championship. You are the first representative from Brazil to do so. How does that feel?
Incredible. I mean, everyone from Brazil was like trying really hard every qualifier. And it's my first qualifier, my first preliminary in play. And I just can't describe how I feel. Like, it's just amazing.
Very impressive, your first preliminary and your first qualifier into the championship of the Hearthstone Championship Tour. Now, tell me a little bit. You had some unusual deck choices. We saw that Bog Creeper Shaman, as well as Freeze Mage and the Worgen OTK Warrior, all pretty high skill cap. How exactly did you go about picking your lineup for this tournament?
Well, the first thing I thought is like, the America meta is like really much more aggro, and I wanted to bring a lineup that counters aggro, so I'm really comfortable playing Freeze Mage like forever. It's my favorite deck for sure, and the Control Shaman like is really good against aggro. I brought like the Yogg-Druid with a lot of taunts. And the OTK Warrior is also really good against aggro. And one thing that's really important is that I thought that some players would try to target Warrior. So I brought the OTK Warrior to win against these players. Like, it's really good against Rhinolock. It's really good against Paladin. So that explains my deck choices. And I'm kind of based my lineup on Nairia's lineup, which is like almost the same deck lists, but with Zoo instead of Freeze Mage.
Well, certainly a great line of thought, and it definitely paid off. Just one final question. Is there anybody that you want to give a shout out to or maybe thank that helped you get all the way here?
Yeah, for sure. Like, every Brazilian player which practiced with me, Loxodontes, Legolas, which did, he helped me a lot with my anxiety. Not sure if that's how you say it. Noblard is like the player that made me be here. Like, Noblard is just the real MVP. And Garifar, Casanova, and everyone from Brazil.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Pascoa. Congratulations once again, and we will be seeing you at the America's Summer Championship next month.
Thank you.
All right, well, let's get a quick preview of the next match. It is going to be Dude7597 versus Muzzy. We did see Dude on stream earlier. Unfortunately, he was not able to win against Monsanto, and Monsanto instead booked his ticket to the championship. So this will be Dude's second and final chance to make it into the top eight and make it to the America's Summer Championship. His opponent is Muzzy, who is the leader in overall Hearthstone Championship Tour points for the entire year and has actually recently joined Luminosity Gaming. So this is going to be a matchup to remember. Let's go ahead and get right into it. Let's throw it over to Frodan and Soddle on the desk.
Two men enter the arena with one chance to go to the Summer Championships, one denied by the fact that he's always been on the cusp of brilliance and supported by his teammates, the other denied by Yogg-Saron himself. My name's Frodan, joined by Soddle once again to cast the second series of Dude7597 up against Muzzy.
Yeah, I'm really excited to get a chance to watch Muzzy play up close and personal. He is a player that we haven't been able to give too much exposure to in these HCT events so far, but I think just empirically, based on, you know, hard data and statistics, he is one of the strongest Hearthstone players in terms of overall ladder win rate. You know, he's absolutely crushing the last call standings.
Certainly.
In terms of total points. And he's just been a player that hasn't been able to put a run together in one of these preliminary tournaments yet. And I think part of that is that I cursed him with one of my predictions in the previous season.
It's true. Actually, none of us touched Muzzy this season, particularly because we always feel like it's almost bad voodoo in a way to predict Muzzy. A lot of us do respect him. In fact, a lot of us do talk to him, and even TJ and them practice with him. He's a very good player. We always felt like it almost adds too much pressure, because there's, if there's anything that Muzzy fully admits, is that he does tend to get nervous a lot. And when the spotlight is on him, he does admit that he chokes at times. Is this another moment where that happens, or will it be finally his time to shine?
It's interesting because he has a little bit of security, so to speak, because we're about to get into game one. Like I said, he is very well positioned in those last cool standings, so he does have a second chance to back him up. If anyone here is going to feel the pressure more of the two, you'd expect it to be Dude, because this is literally his last chance for this year to continue this road towards BlizzCon.
Yeah, it is very true. So let's go into game number one. Freeze Mage up against the Token Druid. We've seen this matchup several times today and has been leaning both ways. You know, we've seen Druids been able to sometimes eke out the win. Freeze Mage able to take it most of the time, though. And so it's not unwinnable on either side. Muzzy, of course, going for the Innervate. Dude is just still going to look for ways to get that efficient removal early on while still being able to maintain his resources.
Yeah, and the list from Muzzy here is very hit and miss against Freeze Mage. He has Sylvanas in his list, which we saw in the Mulligan, which is a big whiff against Freeze Mage because of the exposure it gives you to Doomsayer specifically. But he does also have a copy of Ragnaros the Fire Lord in his deck, which is not something we've seen too much of. And if there's one card that Freeze Mages see in their nightmares, it's Rag.
Yeah, that's what they wake up screaming right at 8 a.m. You know, I do feel like the fact that Muzzy also has chosen not to include Feral Rage into his list isn't actually that big of a deal. I feel like a lot of times the game is determined before it, in the sense that the Freeze Mage is always accounting for things like Feral Rage anyways. So whether or not you're able to put the pressure on is far determined way before Feral Rage becomes a life gain issue.
Right.
It does end up sometimes becoming this thing where, like, you know, Feral Rage and Healing Touch from Raven Idol can put you out of range. That's my opinion. What do you think? I would
mostly agree with that. You know, the game we were watching in the previous series with Freeze Mage against Druid, you know, I think around turn 7 or so, I said, okay, Freeze Mage is pretty much favored here apart from Feral Rage, but even when you say that, like, even if the Feral Rage were to come down, it very often just buys one more turn. And like you said, the Freeze Mage can account for those kind of outs anyway. So generally, you can have all the healing cards, all the sustainability cards, all the answers that you want in your deck. The main thing that any deck needs against Freeze Mage is consistent pressure. If you don't get that, you're just not going to outlast them.
Muzzy, really thinking about all his possibilities, you did mention Ragnaros, and Señor de Fuego is in the hand of Muzzy right now, so whether or not he gets it out early is all that he's thinking about. He was even flirting with the idea of pushing out Nourish early.
I mean, he can do that, right? He can coin himself a Nourish up to 6 mana, use the excess 2 mana to hero power down the Novice Engineer, and then next turn, we just live in Innervate Rag world.
Yeah, that does seem rather strong. He also can do that next turn also. He can play Power of the Wild for 3-2, then Innervate and coin out the Ragnaros while having Nourish to back it up. I do feel like overall getting out those Nourish crystals are important for the longer term, because you do get the benefit off of multiple Innervates the following turns.
Right.
It's just one of those things where maybe Muzzy prioritizes getting a little bit of damage in, maybe even baiting out some of that damage and removal.
I mean, if Rag's on the board and there is no super clean answer to it, that's going to do most of the damage that you need to in that game. It's very, very heavily favored if you get it down super early to fire twice.
Yeah.
So that's at least like half the damage dealt if they both get to go phase.
And the game accelerates very quickly. Sometimes this game gets drawn out very long, and you see Freeze Mage barely hanging in, stalling. All of a sudden, it's like, why did I ever worry? You win the game. Druid, in the meantime, is usually frantic trying to get onto the board. But Ragnaros simplifies it a little bit more on both sides. Ragnaros, for Druid, just says, I want to put as much pressure as possible. And then if Freeze Mage can't answer it, they're often stuck piecing together multiple turns to try and remove it.
Yeah, nothing too glamorous going on in Dude's hand right now. The Acolyte, the only card he has to cycle at the moment, that's just a little bit too slow on the 4-mana turn, so it's just a matter of whether he wants to respect this 3-2 Panther, which seems like a fairly innocuous threat, or whether he just spends his turn going ahead and developing Ice Block here.
It might seem innocuous, but it also is something that he has to account for multiple turns of taking damage.
Yep.
How does he plan to remove it the following turn then, if he's not removing it this turn? And if so, is he willing to accept 6 damage or more?
Sure.
That's one of the things that he's accounting for. I do like the mana efficient play, and I do think that if you're going to be playing along the lines of, well, you know, I do want to start getting out this card draw and secrets out, I don't want to take too much damage. Although, I don't think he has much of a choice this turn on whether or not he wants to accept that damage or not.
Yeah, so I'm sure Muzzy is going to consider all of his options this turn, but come on. There's one play, right? Let's just do it and get it over with.
What? Absolutely. I am a big fan of slamming the Ragnaros on the table and see if dude can just deal with it.
And on five mana, it's just not easy at all. Like, Blood Mage plus spells doesn't really line up. Fireball plus ping, even if that was six mana, is only seven damage. It's just such a nightmare for a deck to deal with whose main strategy is just isolate your minions on the board so they cannot attack just by freezing them. But Ragnaros does not need to attack to deal repetitive damage.
Now, there are ways that dude can try to work around this. He did pick up that Forgotten Torch. He didn't really need that necessarily. He did have two turns of being able to ping down the Ragnaros this turn and then be able to play Acolyte to try to intercept it. He's going to choose instead to Ice Block. Okay. I actually kind of like the Acolyte in a sense. The Force Acolyte. Your opponent to have the removal.
Right. So how many things? I mean, Wrath, Swipe, Druid of the Claw Charge, Spell Power, Living Roots. All of those things kind of give your opponent a turn if that's the kind of texture of his hand at the time. So
sure.
I can definitely see the Ice Block rationale, but trying to live in a dream world here where this rag doesn't connect with your face again for eight might just be the kind of optimism that you need at this point to come out favorably as the Freeze Mage in this position. So
definitely.
I think I'm okay with the Acolyte.
Let's see what Raven Idol comes up with first. Force of Nature, Starfall, Wild Growth. Not the best choices.
No. None of these cards connect with your opponent's face, which is kind of your plan right now.
At least not anymore. Two of these used to.
That's very true. Wow. The glory days of Starfalling Face.
Yeah, or Force of Nature.
Showing your age,
face.
Dan. Yeah.
Not
yeah.
showing my age. Only 90s kids understood that reference, Subtle.
I'm pretty sure the kids understand the Force of Nature nightmare, though. We are still being traumatized by dreams of those charging tree ants.
Yeah, I know I am. Speaking of charge, I'm absolutely in favor of charging this Acolyte down. Yeah, you give your opponent a card, but you get that 8 damage in. And you also know that your opponent's going to be spending the turn playing the Fireball, so you can interpret that this Druid of the Claw will get 4 more damage in.
Yep. Yeah, Druid of the Claw is a persistent source of damage, which is super important after your opponent has telegraphed his next play, and he just has no option but to spend his entire 6 mana on removing that Ragnaros. So, to be clear, that Ragnaros has dealt 16 damage, the entirety of the damage that has been dealt this game, and it also ate 2 entire turns of the Freeze Mage to be able to deal with it.
Yeah, it's pretty brutal. Muzzy not going to be really stopping his momentum anytime soon. Azure Drake, pretty important. Ooh, interesting. Would you like to capitalize on the spell power? Probably not. I mean, the armor up is very relevant, too, getting that damage in. And you can also double swipe the next turn with hero power.
Yeah, gaining the one seems reasonable. And based on your opponent's hand, having just seen one fireball come out, there's a decent chance this Drake isn't just cleanly removed from the board anyway. It's probably just a freeze play most of the time. So. You can still value that most of the time you'll get that value out of swipe anyway, and you're only gaining one extra damage from it anyway, which you get from the hero power, so.
Okay. The Frostbolt, that is your second Frostbolt, but that does allow you to clean remove the board, or even perhaps stall onto it. Like, you can Frostbolt and then play Loot Hoarder or Doomsayer instead as well. You can Forgotten Torch one target. You can Frostbolt the other and play two mana minion, or you can just hero power it down.
It feels so bad, though, to just have those two Ice Lances left in your deck now after both Frostbolts have gone. Like, they're such dead draws at this point if you commit that Frostbolt.
That's a really good point, actually. And perhaps you just save that Frostbolt and play Doomsayer and Loot Hoarder.
It looks like the most promising line. I mean, there's nothing showing a huge amount of promise right now, but that does seem like the most beneficial situation. But swipes are going to be able to clear this up quite nicely, but now there's decisions to be made about going for board presence here or just committing fully to the damage from swipe. I don't mind holding back one swipe in hand because a source of damage that the Freeze Mage can't interact with is very, very important for when they get desperate late in the game. You know, they freeze your board, they Frostbolt your face, but the one thing they can't prevent is you just jamming spells from your hand.
There's actually a way you can utilize Starfall if you want to save the swipe for your face as well. Or sorry, save swipe for the face if you don't want to use that way. But chooses instead to go for this swipe to the face. I like it the most. The most important thing too that I think about Muzzy's hand, he's got so much reload with that nourish. So even if his opponent deals with his board, he's got lots of ways to reload here.
Right.
And dude doesn't exactly have many things in his arsenal. He's got Frost Nova, and he's got that Frostblood Ice Lance, but it's looking at a rather feeble hand.
Yeah, and the crazy thing is he still hasn't found time yet this game to develop an Ice Block, so that there's still three mana over the course of this game that is earmarked for playing that Ice Block in his hand. So,
well, he does have the ability to play Ice Block this turn with Frost Nova, and then he can stall one more turn after that to potentially grab a couple more resources for his Alexstrasza push.
Ooh.
Okay, I mean, Blizzard is more expensive, so if you're going to be playing it, you can do it now.
Mm-hmm. I'm just going to go ahead and start pinging off the armor here. This is something that players have kind of been punished for a little bit in games that we've seen today, is not limiting the Druid armor. So they've managed to stack up a little bit too much and just drag themselves out of range of the counterburn plan. So I like him continuing to make sure that armor is under control here, but Nourish when your board's locked out is one of the strongest plays you can make. He doesn't have too much extra development to make, but Raven Idol, as we've seen, can have a huge impact on the outcome of these games.
Absolutely, and that's the power of Discover. You can choose any card which has flexibility. You have the ability to adapt to situations. Bite, for example, is almost a double threat. You can attack from the hand without having to have a board preemptively do the damage. And you also gain that 4 life, which is not trivial at all.
Yeah, 4 armor, which is a very important distinction against Freeze Mage as well to have.
That's very true. Dude would rather just have the burn, but now with this Acolyte, I mean, is this probably where you set up the Acolyte, Frost Nova, and Ice Block?
It looks that way. It's just how greedy dude decides he can be here. He trusted that he wasn't going to die last turn with a frozen board, which is valid. He can probably feel the same way this turn, so he could try and maximize his Acolyte draws and play around some removal options here by just playing Acolyte Ping and Frost Nova, pinging his own Acolyte. But at some point, the necessity of needing to play that Ice Block needs to go away so that he can free up more mana for himself. Speak to
me. Yeah, I think it would be too greedy to just Frost Nova and ping your Acolyte there. I think there's too much risk involved, because I don't know if you can safely get down Ice Block before Alexstrasza again.
Yeah, I agree. You're even like in niche worlds where, you know, a second swipe plus a swipe that's been taken off Raven Idol just kills you. It's possible, like 11 and 12 is actually a big difference, and the fact there's an extra Raven Idol spell in the hand is a big difference as well in terms of the combinations of cards that kill you. So the safe play here makes sense, but he's so low on resources in hand that Acolyte only picking up one draw is kind of a big deal as well.
Muzzy cycling for some answers here, or better answers, to the Acolyte. Oh, Living Roots. You know, if he actually had the ability to do 11 damage if he played that greedy line.
Yep. Sure did. And Starfall gonna come out here. He can choose to play it in AoE mode for style points if he would like to.
I like that.
There you go. Nice. I like it. It's just a vastly superior animation, which we all know matters enormously.
That's right. Yeah. Some of the power of the moon.
Yep.
Straight to the board. I do wonder if there's any relevance to the fact that the board got full at all. I don't think so, because the opponent did play Frost Nova, so he's limited to just maybe that Blizzard.
Right. And there aren't too many kind of, you know, mandatory minions that's usually reserved, you know, back in the day for things like Antique Healbot, and more currently like Reno Jackson are things that you don't want to fill your board on. There's not too many must play minions in this deck. I guess there is I believe there's only one Druid of the Claw in Muzzy's list, and it's already been played, so even charge is out of the equation, but that is all irrelevant anyway, because the board gets blizzarded away regardless.
Muzzy can pop the Ice Block this turn.
He
has to commit almost everything in terms of damage from the hand. Of course, if you count Yogg-Saron as damage from the hand, which oftentimes I do, if I'm playing a Tempo Mage, for example, I sometimes, if I'm like 3 off lethal, I sometimes just do it.
Mm-hmm. So the danger here with the swipe bite living roots line to pop the ice block is you leave yourself open to potentially losing to just defensive Alexstrasza in that world, because you will generate no board and lower your opponent by committing most of the resources from your hand. And that's kind of the perfect scenario for a defensive Alexstrasza. It's one of the ways that Freeze Mage beats aggressive decks a lot of the time, in that, you know, they just get them down to zero cards in hand, they're able to stabilize the board, and then defensive Alex just clutches it out. But generally, if you can pop the block, you should, and Muzzy is going to agree with that philosophy.
It's also not the end of the world, even if they do Alexstrasza. That means that their offensive capabilities have been limited a lot, especially on a small hand. He only has five cards. So Dude's options are very limited, and I have to anticipate an Alexstrasza this turn.
Yeah, I mean, the offensive Alexstrasza would do 13 points of damage to Muzzy here. Remember, that even with a defensive Alexstrasza, there's still an 8-8 on the board. That can do that same 13 points of damage pretty quickly. So it's not a huge difference, and I think it's just a matter of pure necessity here that we're going to have to see the heal.
I do feel like this all of a sudden gives relevance to the Yogg-Saron. Oh, wow, if you didn't have that Alexstrasza.
Yep.
Yeah. It does give credence to Yogg-Saron more if Alexstrasza sticks onto the board after this turn.
Nyxia picked up no mulch, which I'm sure is what he was digging for. The two extra mana from the Fandral effect means that he would have been able to cast the mulch there if available, but Wrath and Living Roots only going to pick up 6 damage here, so one card off. So the Alexstrasza will be able to attack freely and connect where it likes here.
Melee still is at 35, which is still a long way from what Dude has. Dude's also yet to hit a lot of his power cycling through Novice Engineers, so we could anticipate that Muzzy, in the next couple of turns, will just watch Dude draw into a much bigger hand. At the same time, Fandral is pretty threatening too, so Dude has to remove that.
Yes, indeed. But Forgotten Torch, Frostbolt, Ice Lance. Ice Lance is 14 damage in the hand plus the Alex. So we're up to 22 of that 35 already. But as you said, there is no protection in place for the Freeze Mage right now. That 15 health is just what he has to play with right now. So he cannot afford to go aggressive here. He has to address this board state.
What if he... is there any way to... pseudo freeze Ice Lance perhaps once, like maybe Ice Lance to Fandral and expect Alexstrasza to connect?
Ooh. I think having seen your opponent just slam it down to 2 on the previous turn, it's purely how much do I need this 8 right now to connect with face. You know this is all you're getting, right? There's no way you're going to bank on this surviving for another turn. So he decides he's going to value that 8 damage a lot. And he is just going to go ahead and Emperor and try and find his way through purely with this pile of burn that he has left in play.
Okay, 3, 4, not too much damage onto the board right now, but Muzzy still has that Fandral available to him to Wrath and draw a card first. Well, I guess via Teacher so he can get the token.
Teacher Wrath Mulch is possibly what ends up happening here. Interesting, he's gonna just use the Mulch on the Emperor here. The thing that jumped out at me straight away was just Wrathing away the Alexstrasza and Mulching the Emperor so you could push face for maximum damage, but he's actually gonna trade, which makes me wonder what this Mulch is for. I guess he hasn't seen a single Doomsayer yet at this point, so once the 8-2 was devalued, I guess he's reassigning this Mulch to a Doomsayer.
It's a lot of damage. You said 14 earlier with the hand, so that means it's a 20.
That is 20.
With an investment of the Roaring Torch, it's getting close.
21 with the ping as well. I think Dude is just going to go here. There's 9 damage in play on the Druid side. So 10 with the hero power.
There is a Savage Roar in the deck of Muzzy. So something to consider, but I don't think you're really worried about that. I think you just have to figure out a way to win the game as opposed to just survive. And the ping is pretty relevant. The hero power is very relevant. He's also keeping his hand in case of Blood Mage Thauno so he can extend his damage even further.
Ancient of War picked up is a whiff. It's a hugely powerful card in the deck, but it's not damage, which is all he's looking for right now. So Muzzy is going through. You can see that look in his eyes as he stares off to one side. He is calculating all the combinations of Freeze Mage cards and how much damage exactly they do. So he will have seen his opponent put one Frostbolt onto the board already, so he's going to rule that out of the equation. So he is thinking of combinations of cards that kill him here, how important it is for example, that he plays his only defensive option in this situation, which is to rely on Yogg to gain him life. But I think he will quickly come to the conclusion that his opponent is putting himself on a very niche out here and just play the most solid aggressive line that he can make.
Absolutely. I think just go for a very solid gameplay.
He's going for the Yogg. Whoa, okay.
His hero power is live, which means he has cast Innovate. Conceal is a good start.
Okay, and I guess as long as he's not doing damage to himself, he's okay with this. Savagery came to the hand. And also, he has to kind of make up his mind on how to do something, because he has to hero power quickly move. He's just going to go ahead and make this decision firsthand, like before seeing the end of result of Yogg.
That's the Innovate that we knew he had.
Oh, he can also do damage to his opponent. Oh, wait, his minions don't die. That's
his minions
so
don't
funny.
Die.
Oh, I one time played this combination with Patron Warlock, where you just use Spreading Madness on patrons. It's very funny.
Mortal Strike!
Nope. Well, looks like in the end, as long as he doesn't do damage to any of the targets of heroes, ooh, nothing really changes. Oh, the
he's fatigued himself, which is another concern that he really had to consider when deciding to play the Yogg there. So he managed to gain one life from the Innovate, allowing him to hero power.
Whoa.
The Frost Nova pickup.
The Frost Nova pickup.
Wow, this is huge.
That's massive, giving him another turn. That means Muzzy's going to take 2 damage from fatigue.
The crazy thing is here that most of the time, just buying yourself a turn isn't going to do anything in this state. But now Muzzy has cast Yogg and fatigued himself, turns is all dude needs. If he can buy a turn every turn, Muzzy is eventually just going to die from drawing fatigue damage from his deck.
How many cards remain in Dude's deck? Because right now, Muzzy's not going to do anything. I mean,
he's going to hear a power.
Maybe Power of the Wild at best, but that's about it. There's 11 cards, so he needs to finish that one card. He can
Loot
still
Hoarder.
Get it.
Pingo Loot Hoarder.
Runner, runner, perhaps.
Fireball.
One time.
Roaring Torch.
Oh. No. Wow. Least impactful card. And Muzzy does a fist bump, realizing how close that actually was. And as Yogg-Strong was not willing to be partial to anybody, he was actually quite neutral in that effect. He didn't just basically build the board and drew cards.
Hey, well, I can't help but feel like that was a really ambitious Yogg-Strong, though. Like, what combination of cards was he scared of? Because I think the Forgotten Torch had only been cast, for example, when all those cards were in hand, so he couldn't have been putting him on a Roaring Torch being one of the cards in his hand. So
right.
What combination of 17 damage was he really scared of in that situation?
Weren't 2 torches cast? I think one was cast
very
really?
Early. Oh, okay.
And then he casted one.
Yeah,
at
sure.
The very
that
end.
Changes things a little bit then.
So if there's 2 out, and then he was calculating all the draws that he'd seen at that point. So he says, I haven't seen Novice or either of those novices, so that does add the ability to draw, or even Arcane Intellect to potentially draw 2.
He also hadn't seen Doomsayer. At least one Frost Nova, the Mirror Image.
Right.
There's a lot of whiffs in there as well.
There were whiffs, and I believe there was a second Ice Block too in the deck.
Yes.
So that is another turn to draw. Muzzy's calculating how many cards, and it's a lot of math, and I think that's why he got to that rope. He's like, well, I got to also see the result of Yogg-Saron.
Can you imagine, after the Yogg like drew him into fatigue, if like one of his draws was Ice Block, and Ice Block was just lethal, because it gave you that one extra turn to get to let your opponent
that's
die
crazy,
to fatigue.
Man. That's crazy.
Yeah.
So we're going into game number 2 with a 1-0 lead for Muzzy. The Druid does prevail. Now this is an aggressive Shaman deck, I believe, from Muzzy. Nothing too out of the ordinary.
It is, yep.
The thing that is out of the ordinary, of course, is his Reno Warlock deck, but we'll talk about that more in the upcoming games.
Yeah, this is just the perfectly core and standard aggro Shaman list as time has gone on. There was one Flame Juggler in the list originally that has been replaced with a Lightning Storm, but 90% of players favor this core list of 29 to 30 cards. Exactly, with maybe 1 or 2 flexes. Muzzy no different, just going with the solid, consistent aggro Shaman list.
That is a brutal open hand. And look at how efficient it is, too. Muzzy can also piece together Lightning Bolt Argent Squire in case he doesn't want to play the Totem Golem.
Yeah.
Because dude also has a great opening hand with Flame Imp and the Voidwalker, or just perhaps challenging the Flame Imp and saving the coin for a 3-mana play.
Yeah. These are the matches that Aggro Shaman actually quite often wins in this matchup. Zoo is favored, but if Aggro Shaman is able to piece together its 1 and 2 drops in its opening hand, it can compete and gain an early advantage. The problem is that Zoo just plays so many more of those cards that they do that a lot more efficiently. They're not being weighed down by all the Doomhammers and Lava Bursts and Thing from Below's, etc. So This is looking promising for Muzzy, but the double one drop start from Zoo at least shuts down some of the ability for Muzzy to just completely blow the turn out with Argent Squire into Lightning Bolt.
Yeah, that if Dude didn't get this Voidwalker out, that could just be lights out already. So very crucial turn here. Now, of course, Muzzy is complicated. His turn is complicated too. If he Lightning Bolts, it's no longer a clean removal. So if you do Lightning Bolt the Flame Imp, or if you choose to play Totem Golem, do you also bump into the Voidwalker?
It's an excellent question. He does also. There's also a third option, which is Lightning Bolt the Voidwalker and trade for the Flame Imp.
Oh, that's right.
Like, make yourself a 1-1 ahead of the play. I can see merits in both of these lines. Generally, anytime you can clear your opponent's board against a Zoo player and just have a minion in play yourself, like, that's a promising position for you. But Muzzy might also decide the board tension, like you described, is weighted heavily in his favor, which I'd kind of agree with. I think all things considered, bolt the Flame Imp and bump into the Voidwalker is probably the strongest line.
He's making this safe. Oh, okay. Ah, actually, I do like this attack aggressively.
Face. Interesting.
Okay, because how does the opponent punish it? Most likely the Flame Imp is going to trade into it anyways.
Yep.
So that was actually a good spot there for Muzzy. And that damage does truly matter, especially for Shaman, because at one point they're going to really struggle to get the damage in.
Yeah, Abusive Sergeant, really huge tempo tool in these kind of early board contested matchups between two aggressive decks. Dragon Egg also a sticky minion that can be a little bit of insurance against Lightning Storm in the matchup, which is one of the ways that you can lose. But I like the Abusive Sergeant more than anything for sure. It's just such a powerful tool. One of the just strongest cards in the game, honestly.
That's a fantastic draw here from Muzzy as well. Because before, I was wondering, you know, if he plays Totem Golem, that Flamely Face is stranded in the hand.
Yep.
With nobody to stay back with him on the bench. Flametongue Totem instead, though. He's the hero of the hand right now, being able to free up the mana for the next turn. And Dude, once again, has to deal with this pretty annoying board.
Yeah, no real options in hand here for Dude. He's just going to have to drop that 1-5 Councilman. And there is a 4-mana 7-7 in his future, although now, not necessarily, although playing both of these overload cards this turn, which is the alternative play, the Totem Golem and the Lightning Bolt, would again lock him out of that 4-mana card as a follow-up.
You're almost conceding the fact that you will lose your Flametongue Totem then? If
yes.
You play your Flame Wreath Faceless. The benefit, of course, is that you have the seven mana, or the seven attack and seven health to use to kill your opponent. I think you're wondering about what are the ways you can get punished for this really heavily.
Right.
And the follow-up to Darkjar Councilman, what are the ones that we're really afraid of? Forbidden Ritual, perhaps?
Not good enough in this situation.
Defender of Argus, not really.
Yeah. It just doesn't, the threat just doesn't seem to be there. 7-7 on the board seems strong. It's just, the only downside of this is that maybe the Zoo opponent like creates a situation where you're obligated to send your 7-7 into the Councilman next turn anyway.
Right.
And that whole scenario playing out just slows you down a little bit too much overall. So what Muzzy is doing here is recognizing exactly that situation and trading the Argent Squire. This way, there is no way he has to trade that 7-7 into the Councilman next turn. He can just Lightning Bolt it.
Yeah, very good observation. Now, there is an answer from Dude. He can just use his double abusive and trade into it. Pretty brutal, super efficient, like you were talking about. Man, he gets the development of this Shadow Beast, the Possessed Villager.
Yeah, that's one of those sad situations in Hearthstone where you make what is probably a very insightful, high-level, and correct play, and just the way the cards line up punish you for it. Because yeah, he was playing around much more likely scenarios in terms of not being able
right.
to deal with the Councilman, but he ran into an unlikely scenario when he just essentially threw away his Argent Squire for absolutely no reason.
Now, to be fair, if Dude also had a good amount of response too with Power Overwhelming, even if it wasn't double Abusive Sergeant, he saw it off of the Dark Peddler, which is what usually gets the people most upset, but he did have that option, and now he can keep that Power Overwhelming for better use, such as now, if he chooses to go for it, or he can choose to play the Dark Iron Dwarf and hold on to the Power Overwhelming if he feels like he doesn't need it. Because you can also isolate the Flametongue Totem, make it feel like it's relatively powerless.
Yeah, the PO is gonna go in, pick up the trade here, and now Zhu is just kind of doing what Zhu does in this matchup, and that's just getting board control far too early. The Shaman has not been able to push through enough damage, and this is just gonna be the constant struggle now for Shaman to come back onto the board and build a platform, but Zhu just has too many tools to keep denying that from happening.
Oh boy, well, that is quite a doozy to get the Sea Giant out early. Really interesting interaction, of course, with Forbidden Ritual and Sea Giant. It's very difficult to put both at the same time. It usually never happens.
Right. Just a pro tip for Dude here, based on some of the play that we've seen today, he should play this Sea Giant before making any trades on the board.
Oh no. Ooh, are you sure he's the one who needs to get
I couldn't resist. It was low hanging fruit. It was just low hanging fruit. It looked tempting. I just had to grab it, pluck it down from the branches.
Saddle has no chill.
Ouch.
But yeah, that is how Sea Giant works. Trying to complicate the board state by introducing these 2-3 taunt minions and getting in the way of Sea Giant. But, at this point, there's no real answer, and the health total is not a real concern for Dude, because it's not like he's going to be worried about being burned down.
Thing from below is, again, just one of the most powerful pickups in Muzzy's deck, but it's just not going to be enough. Zhu has well and truly run away with this game. The Crazed Alchemist was important. It felt like that Feral Spirits was the last potential push, being able to lock out some of that board, but Crazed Alchemist being put up, although honestly, any buff card would have done the job, essentially. But the fact that a buff or, you know, at least a combat trick was drawn on that turn was pretty important, because that felt like Muzzy's last hurrah in this matchup.
Muzzy does have the ability to get the Lightning Storm, but the big problem in the big picture is that Dude will be drawing two cards per turn very freely, so that he'll always be resources behind. It almost doesn't matter if Muzzy draws Lightning Storm, because Dude will be able to replace it with the inevitable draws of Imp Gang Boss and really efficient minions like Doomguard.
Yeah, basically all Lightning Storm will do is ensure that Muzzy loses one or two turns slower than he was going to do beforehand. So he's going to need to find some way to swing the board while playing a Lightning Storm, which if a Dude just doesn't allow him to keep any minions on the board, just isn't going to be relevant. He's going to need Finley into a life tap of his own at a bare minimum in this game.
Okay, so the Power Whelming, very efficient trade. So he's gonna put his opponent down to just a couple of turns here. Sea Giant's gonna attack super aggressively. And Muzzy, if you don't really have anything next turn, I think that's just gonna be lights out. And we're already pretty pessimistic. This is not the Rosty version where you're putting in the Hex to just try to tech your opponents out, take advantage of things like Sea Giant.
Yeah, and Tunnel Trog, just know what he's gonna need, and not quite facing down lethal on board, but he knows a lost game when he sees one. He's going to give it up, and we're going to move on with the series tied 1-1.
Okay, so the series is evened up. The Zoo Warlock definitely felt like it was one of the better decks in this series for Dude, so don't blame him at all. It felt like it was pretty good against all three of the decks.
Right.
So just get that win out of the way. The bigger question is, how does Muzzy's Reno Warlock fare against Dude's Freeze Mage? Like, these are the more wild card decks in general.
Yeah, I mean, Reno Lock is a deck that used to at least stand a chance against Freeze Mage. Some people thought it did okay because you could play around with the healing numbers using cards like Antique Healbot a lot more, whereas now you only have small incremental heals, like maybe a Farseer, maybe a Refreshment Vendor, but your only real burst heal effect in the deck is Reno Jackson. So a lot of the time, Freeze Mage can just set up scenarios where they trade a fireball for your Reno, essentially, right? They fireball you in the face, and then you go, oh god, I have to Reno now, and then like the Alex comes down, and that's just pretty much the end of the game.
I'm trying to look if there's any exceptions in Muzzy's list that might prove us wrong otherwise. For example, in Sixo's list, he had a Schefter Xeris, and he did manage to get Bolf Ram Shield on curve to start making sure that he had that extra armor. And this is going to be rough here. I think Muzzy really wanted to cue the Shaman into this matchup specifically, because also the Shaman against the Warrior is tricky.
Oh, strike one, Dan. Conquest pick order. Violation.
Not really.
Moving on.
No, I'm just saying, Muzzy's just, he doesn't really want this matchup.
Right, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree, it's fine.
Okay.
You look so confused right now.
I am confused. Okay. Let's mistake move number one, Conquest pick order.
Yeah. Don't worry. It's fine. Let's move forward.
Yeah, well, that's just like your opinion, man.
Sure. Let's go with that. So we are going to find out exactly firsthand who wins this matchup. It's not a matchup that I've seen too much in standard format. Both of these decks have kind of faded a little bit in popularity since the standard format rotated. But it's what this matchup is going to be defined by if the Reno Lock is able to win. It's going to be pressure. It's not going to be healing. It's not going to come down to a Reno a lot of the time. It's can they put enough pressure on the Freeze Mage with kind of the awkward collection of minions that they have to force the Freeze Mage into awkward decisions.
Oh, yeah. Sargon's of Sigil is a pretty awkward card for a Freeze Mage
really
to deal
is,
with.
Yeah.
That's like an untouchable Ancient of War. The only way you can is through Doomsayer.
Yeah, pretty much the only way it's going to get dealt with. I mean, even stacking up two or three AoE spells isn't going to rush down the 9 health. So, you know, like you said, Doomsayer needs to go off in that situation. But dude has got plenty of time here just to happily develop through his opening hand. Again, missed out on a lot of the early cycle. Does have the Acolyte of Pain, which can start to generate some cards for him in the mid game. But for now, he's just kind of stuck developing secrets and chilling and waiting to react to what Muzzy does here.
Yeah, dude doesn't have the best hand. He's got couple of decent cards for the early game phase. Doomsayer, the Acolyte of Pain to help him draw, but okay. I guess he has the Ice Barrier this turn. Definitely not really feeling much of the Acolyte here.
Okay,
chooses to Doomsayer. This Barrier is probably his best chance. Yeah. The only way he can answer through a Spellbreaker on turn 4, which I believe Muzzy actually mulliganed away.
Yeah, there's also no Stampeding Kodo in Muzzy's list. Coin Kodo would be a potential punish here, or actually an insured punish. He could trade into both of the 0-2s first, but he's just going to have to let this thing go off. And this also gets a kind of awkward card out of the hand here in the form of Mirror Image, because Mirror Images is one of the only few ways in this Freeze Mage deck that you can allow your opponent to get Cult Apothecary value, which is one of the things that could change the equation potentially in the mid game.
That's a good point.
So getting rid of that Mirror Image and getting use out of it in the early game is actually beneficial in a multitude of ways.
All right, Coin Emperor Thorasan. First to disrupt his opponent's Emperor Thorasan, and also just to reduce the cost of his clunky hand. Cards like Jaraxxus never feel very playable, but when you can get Saga to Slither one turn earlier, I'm pretty happy, Camper.
Yeah, Sogoth coming down on turn 8. It's getting closer and closer to that Ancient of War comparison that you made. It's now getting down in cheaper as well, and there's not a great-looking way to deal with this Emperor Thorasan yet, so Can we live the dream here? Can we actually get a 7-mana Sogoth?
Yeah, it is possible. I mean, what's really the worst case scenario? Okay, it's Arena Warlock, so they can get a lot of card discounts.
Yeah.
And I think one of the ways you would lose is if the board pressure gets too much and you can't answer it, considering you don't have Frostnova or Blizzard. I'd probably put this threat at code orange at the least. not also because Emperor Thorasan is shaded by the power of Ragnaros, which is inflamed by orange fires around him, if you can see it.
Sure.
Yeah.
But if it's only code orange, is that really a Frostbolt Ice Lance situation? Is that not a reaction that is only deemed necessary for code red?
Yeah, I think if it's code yellow, even the TSA just taught me that that's enough to do anything. To do anything it takes.
Fair enough. Mortal Coil being cycled here as a 0-mana card being cycled into a fresh card that can now be discounted. And it's happening. He has turned his Sogoth into a 7-mana untargetable Ancient.
Not bad at all. I'm actually really excited for the possibilities of Arena Warlock and then Karazhan, if I could just put that as a small thing in, by the way. Because I was thinking of Sogoth, and I'm like, that kind of looks like the Curator a little bit, but the art is like in the side, just because it's very glowy. And it's like 7-mana taunt and draws cards. Like, oh, it's crazy. It'd be so cool to sneak it into Arena Warlock decks or Reno Mage decks,
right,
etc.
Right. Yeah, in Reno decks specifically, where it's like, I'm going to play a few of these awkward cards anyway, because I need to fill my deck up. Like, it makes a lot of sense, but the more pressing issue right now is this Emperor on the board, which is just getting all the value in the world for Dude.
What happened?
The thing is now is we've committed to the world where this Emperor is not worth a Frostbolt Ice Lance. right?
So he's already got his value.
Yeah, it's like if we didn't do it on the previous turn, it would now just kind of be a deviation from your line to do it on any following turn. So dude is kind of now stuck into this stubborn world where he's just going to refuse to remove this Emperor over and over again.
Yep, and it's one of those things too where it's also just kind of stubbornness. You just really have to deal with this and hope that your opponent doesn't have the perfect removal, which if he does go for a Doomsayer, there is removal in Muzzy's hand, too, for that Doomsayer. And he's getting Emperor to attack face multiple turns. This is, like, one of the ways Reno Lock can actually come back here.
Yeah, and just look at this hand. We saw a similar hand in that 6-0 game that you were referencing, because in that game, while the Bulf was there the whole time, there was also an Emperor chilling on the board. But
right.
That hand was kind of full of weird situational cards like Demon Rats and Shadow Bolts and Mortal Coils. And this card just has bombs in it, like Sylvanas, Jiraxxus. Like, it just has threats going on. He's going to be able to Jiraxxus for ridiculously small amounts of mana if the game ever progresses to that point.
It might actually be damage finisher if he needs it. Right. In a situation where he likes to, like, Hellfire Jiraxxus for 6 damage burst and kill his opponent. We'll see. Shadow Flame, not one of the more useful cards here. And of course, Emperor does put some fear in the heart of the Reno Warlock. That is usually the moment where if you see that Emperor Thorsan, it implies that the Freeze Mage has a decent hand where they can maybe kill you with the cards in the hand.
Yep. And Emperor does change the equation. Of course, 21 is the magic number that a Freeze Mage can do to you with maximum mana and Blood Mage still available to them. But once Emperor has come down, pretty much all bets are off in terms of combinations of cards they can deal with, especially if they've already loaded Roaring Torches into their deck.
I'm interested if Muzzy chooses to play any of the cards in his hand, things like Infested Tauren or anything else, so that way it's stickier. If his opponent chooses to play Blizzard and trade in, kind of just force him to do stuff. He's also playing the Farseer just in case. Although it makes sense given that he doesn't have Brand Bronzebeard in his deck list, so it's not like he's saving heals to get maximum value out of it.
Ooh. That is 2 Frostbolts, 2 Ice Lances already, so that's 14 again amassed in hand from Dude, but 14 against 26 in a deck that does play a few incremental heals, and if you are just going to go and commit to the burn face plan, then that's the world where Reno Jackson does punish you incredibly hard.
When you're staring at 15 on the board.
Right.
You do have Frost Nova to stall for one turn, and then you have Ice Block to buy it turn after. However, you're still far away. I mean, you could realistically just pick up cards that you can't really play for a while.
What to do?
I mean, dude, considering his options here, he's choosing essentially which side to send this loot hoarder in, changes his mind and goes for the Infested Tauren, picks up Forgotten Torch, which is ideal, honestly. It's one of those cards that he's going to need to cast at some point to load his deck up with more burn if he is on the burn strategy, which, I mean, take a look at his hand, right? What other strategy does he have?
Yeah, I think he has to do that. I don't know if he can even take this 15. He definitely has to Frost Nova.
Yeah, agreed.
He has to also move quickly. He doesn't want to move the single ping. Did he get it? I think he got it.
Looks fine, yeah.
Yeah. It is one of those tight situations, and every damage does matter. Muzzy does have a way to answer this with Shadow Flame on the Power of Overwhelming. It is something to consider, too. You always have to have an ability to answer specifically this combination of cards.
Yep. It's just, I guess he will use... Well, no, the Infested Tauren doesn't quite get the job done, so he'll have to use the Earthen Ring Farseer instead. Yeah, that is what he's going to go for. Does take the time out to generate another threat on the board in the form of the 4-8, and chooses not to tap this turn. Yeah. So this is trying to survive specifically this turn versus digging through the deck for damage. Dude, hands up in the sky. That is 20 damage with the Fireball Frostbolt double, the double Frostbolt double Ice Lance, 21 right. With the ping as well.
He needs to be patient as well. I think one of the things dude's doing is he knows his play, but he needs to make it seem complicated.
Yep.
Because if he goes all in right here, all of a sudden Drax's heal is actually extremely relevant. So you don't actually want to go all in. You want to go halfway. Fireball and Hero Power of the Face.
Yeah, basically you need to keep 15 damage in your hand. Right.
So
like if Drax's comes down, you win the game. This would surprise me.
No, it's a bluff tactic. I think dude immediately leaned back in his chair and looked at ease. And I think these are the things where he's just trying to make it seem like, oh my goodness, I don't have the damage. What am I gonna do? Oh, will anybody save me? Laughing, help me, please. You know, all these different things that he's probably pretending, but he's not fooling anybody. The damage is still there. It's very relevant.
Oh, wow, look at this. That is the world's worst bluff. I have never seen anything worse.
I don't know about you. I'm giving him the Oscar immediately. For his role as Clueless Freeze Mage, the Oscar goes to... Opens up envelope awkwardly. Dude, 7597.
I didn't expect this. This was totally rad. I would happily play this guy in a high-stakes poker based on his bluffing abilities so far.
Seven Souls is a pretty important card, by the way.
It is.
I think that's going to mean Dude need to have just a little bit extra. We should do some math. So right now, Dude can do 21 from the hand.
Yes.
Muzzy wants to pop the ice block.
Yeah, his only tool to pop, or his only tools to pop, are Hellfire and Jiraxxus, which if either of those cards are cast, he is dead in every world. Even if Siphon is cast afterwards, it would only put him to 15 or back to 21 where he started, which is just dead.
He needs to heal with Siphon Soul, though. Oh, here we go, and I think that's it. I don't really blame him for the play because he tried to pop the ice block, but Dude does have...
The bluff is going to work! I have no time for the bluff has worked! Dude manages to conceal the fact that he has 21 damage exactly in hand. Dang. Picks up a Forgotten Torch as well for good measure. And Dude is going to the hill 2-1.
Oh, he's going to put Muzzy on match point. And once again, going to get at the door once more to see if he can get over that last hump. He's been here before. He's had 2 wins in the series, 1 game away from qualifying. And he has to do it with his Dragon Warrior deck. But a job well done. The Freeze Mages, I believe, have been holding it down in the Hearthstone Championship Tour. I think a lot of criticism has been hitting the players lately because there's been a lot of public outcry for, you know, the players to step up their game. And a lot of them have been, especially on the Freeze Mage side. Right. And I feel like Dude is reflective of that, too. And the cool thing is he's not exactly even the most well-known player. He might be one of the most relevant people in the past couple hours, given the state of how he didn't get into the championship last time. But if there's any justice, you can see that this guy is really trying to as everything in his willpower to get through.
Yeah, and the one remaining deck for him is Dragon Warrior. His list plays an Onyxia and no Deathwing, but that's enough about Dragon Warrior. No one wants to talk about that deck. Let's talk about the big picture here, which is this is a really important game for Dude, because I made this point before, Muzzy does have a second chance. He has a fallback if he is to fall out of this tournament. That's not to say that this match isn't important to him, but he is sitting pretty in that last call standings, which means he has another 8-man to play through to try and book a spot. For Dude, this series right here is all or nothing for his chances this year.
It's true. He also has 2 margins for error with losing this game and then has 1 more game after that.
Yep.
Muzzy, I guess I do see what you're saying. He does have this last call, so it's not truly over for the journey of the Hearthstone Championship Tour. But why put yourself through 3 more series if you can just win 1 more?
I'm not saying he's going to throw this game to be a nice guy to Dude and like go on to the last call qualifier. I'm just saying if the pressure is on one of these players, you know, just in terms of the gravity of what they've been working for all year, you know, Dude can see the end staring him in the face. This is literally his last chance, whereas Muzzy does have that fallback.
I know exactly what I'm saying. I'm just explaining that. It's like, it's not exactly the easiest either because you're also playing 8 really good players.
Yes.
You're playing... the number 2 player right behind you in Frozen, also a teammate, and you also have BB Gun Gun Neobilia right behind their tails as well. It's a very competitive top 8, and I wouldn't be surprised if Muzzy's just even more afraid of them than losing right here. That's one of those scenarios that's
just
really
hard.
I
would buy that too, but remember, this game here is not the end of the road to get that BlizzCon spot afterwards. This only puts them into another pool of, again, 8 very strong players who are going to fight it out for that BlizzCon spot. So. Yeah. Either way, there is still a long road ahead for either of these players, but it is going to come down to these Dragon Warrior games. Possibly 1, possibly 2. But either way, Dragon Warrior is going to decide the fate of these two players.
We're going to have the championships in September, and then the last call will be shortly after, in early October, I believe, in preparations for the BlizzCon opening weekend, as well as the festivities over at the main event. It's always going to be a good time. Highly recommend that you guys tune in, as well as check it out. Plus, by the championships, Sato, we'll have all four wings of Karazhan released. And I have been trying to squeeze in some games because the ladder right now is very chaotic. And I don't want to declare anything too early. I don't want to, you know, get too excited here. But I've been playing a lot of Priest, and it's not that bad.
Ooh, dangerous words, Dan.
It's not the worst.
Dangerous
I've
words.
Revived Injured Blade Master 4 or 5 times in a game, and I don't lose those games except to Miracle Rogue.
No, I mean, so, Priest has been given some strong cards. I think people have overlooked outside of Purify exactly how strong some of the other cards are.
Which already baffles me, too, but we can talk about that later on.
Sure.
Yeah.
But no Priest in sight here, just the aggressive powerhouse that is the Dragon Warrior coming up against. First and foremost, it appears to be the Reno Lock from Muzzy.
Yeah, I do feel like this is Muzzy's best chance to grab the important W here. The Reno Warlock is designed to kill a lot of warriors generally into the lineup. This is why you actually leave Warrior up. You're not that afraid of it as the Reno Warlock. You have so many answers to what they do, and you have access to all this area of effect cards.
It's just the lore. Reno players, every single one of them. It is just the lore. They are mandated to draw Imp Gang Boss on turn three single time.
Is that a personal, trigger button for you?
It just happens. I swear, just with incredible consistency, that card from the far right, every single time, turn three, Imp Gang Boss. Muzzy just doesn't even play it.
I think
he just has sympathy for triggering me, honestly. He just decided not to play it.
It is a very hard card to answer. I do feel like he is very afraid of a Core Carn Elite from his opponent. His opponent hasn't played anything really substantial in the first few turns here. So he was saying if he played, you know, the Corcoran Elite, he would have been in big trouble.
Yeah, not only Coin Corcoran, but just Ravaging Ghoul on curve was a reasonable play there as well. Just hit into the Imp Gang Boss, play Ravaging Ghoul. So he's just essentially saying, I'm the control deck here. I don't really need to develop to give you plays. So I'm just going to hold back, get some more resources in my hand. I'm going to play this Imp Gang Boss on a turn where it's a little bit more awkward for you.
He was offered a Bloodsail Corsair once upon a time. I guess he was hoping for that, but Voodoo Doctor, guess better than nothing. Free life tap, perhaps?
Yeah, not too bad. Probably preferable to the Flame Imp. This Flame Imp is more of an aggressive card than a controlling card, so I can definitely see him picking up the Voodoo Doctor here just for a bit of extra stability.
All right, well, dude does want to think about removal, but he also wants to think about when he can flip the switch. I think for a while, because he doesn't have true board control, until he drops a big threat, he can still just play the removal game. We've seen some Dragon Warriors just get really aggressive, kind of ignore the board and try to lower the opponent's health as much as possible. Mm-hmm. However, I don't think that's applicable right now for dude.
No, I would agree. Muzzy still just has not had the security of drawing Reno in either of these games so far. Reno, of course, would have been of huge significance in that matchup against the Freeze Mage, but just having Reno in your hand in any matchup gives you so much more security to play more bravely with this deck. So the fact that he's not hitting it so far in the top part of his deck is making his plays just a little bit more awkward overall.
Definitely. Ooh, life tap, the best option there for dude. I guess you could also argue the steady shot's very strong against Reno Lock.
Yeah, steady shot tends to be at the most powerful in games where they don't draw Reno, whereas in games where they do draw Reno, life tap is a lot more important because you need to be able to continue to out-resource them and maintain the board through their healing. So life tap probably the most consistent overall because it can still help you win those games where they don't draw, but it gives you that extra security if you do have to beat Reno Jackson.
This is a tough turn. You have a lot of options at your disposal if you're Muzzy, and you have to map out what it implies to over time. So if you play Emperor Thorazhan, are you willing to accept all this damage? If you play Sylvanas, can you realistically not die before her death rattle becomes relevant?
Right.
And then, you know, do you want to play off mana just so that way you can not take as much damage?
Yeah, it's a really tough decision here. I'm not sure if we ever see Sylvanas as the play. I think if we're going to go for a bravery play here, it's probably the Emperor, because Sylvanas is a line that's going to reduce the opponent's board size a lot of the time, whereas you want to give your opponent here the opportunity to push all in, and then that cheap Cult Apothecary that you now have can be your reload for you.
It's true.
So yeah, I like the Emperor line here. Like I said, this is recognition of a situation where he's decided he needs to take a risk, and I think Emperor is a stronger risky play here than Sylvanas is.
Dude actually has a very convenient amount of damage spread here. He can remove the Emperor and put his opponent down to 16 health, which is actually very crucial that you don't activate the Draconoid Crusher, because you don't want it to get big game huntered. I've seen a lot of players actually play around that specifically.
Interesting. Yeah. The worlds of playing around Big Game Hunter have been long past in most matchups. It used to be that your Edwin was always a 6-6. It never got bigger than that. Mm-hmm. But now these days, they're all in on the 12-12s, the 14s. But this time, here you see it. Just that 6-6 developed on the board to play around that Big Game Hunter. Not something we've seen in a long time.
Okay, but Muzzy does have the Twisting Nether to remove everything here, putting the Voodoo Doctor out. Tempo Voodoo Doctor!
Ooh, got him! 2-1 on the board!
Doctor 1 in the house?
Yup, Ravaging Ghoul does look like a clean answer, but the difference between playing a Ravaging Ghoul or a huge threat this turn in the form of, honestly, Draconid Crusher, Rag, or Grom is just so huge that we'll probably see the Ravaging Ghoul being bypassed, honestly. Oh, maybe not. We're going to see tap Ravaging Ghoul, it looks like.
Yeah, it's not even necessarily just like the big threat of Big Game Hunter, but it also could be Siphon Soul. There's multiple ways for your single targets to get removed, so he'd rather have things like Draconoid Crusher absorb the removal first.
Yep. That's going to be tap coin 6 drop then, and again, Draconoid Crusher being played as a 6-6. So with Rag in hand now having been drawn, of course this was newly drawn this turn, but with Rag in hand, would he perhaps have wished that he did test for a Big Game Hunter with one of these Draconids up until now?
Yeah, that's actually really funny the way that works. Because when I saw in the previous game, I believe it was Hoi versus Naaman, and it was at a Star Ladder Finals. Mm-hmm. Because Naaman played around Big Game Hunter, he actually won the game. Hoi did not have any ability to play a swingy turn, and then just got overwhelmed because he held all his damage. This is not the case, too, because in a very odd way, he kind of wants that Big Game Hunter out, so Ragnaros and Grommash are more free to roam the streets of the board.
Yeah, and there it's not too big an option here. It just looks like it has to be Grom and double trade, but the Mortal Coil in hand, able to take care of the 6-1, and he has a multitude of options to take care of the 10-4, Siphon Soul and Big Game Hunter available. Even has the Shatter Flame. Yeah, Demon Wrath too. Just take your pick. You just have a multitude of riches in hand right now. We're going to start with the Mortal Coil. Picks up a Harvest Golem. Senjin going to be developed here. And he's just going to go ahead and play for the tempo here. Sees a huge control on the board now with this initiative. And that tempo Voodoo Doctor that we mocked early on has been getting in there.
I wasn't mocking it. I respect the Voodoo Doctor. He's gotten 4 damage in so far. That's not bad for 1 mana. It's an investment.
They also heal for 2.
Ravaging Ghoul coming out. Execute is being debated, and I'm sure will in the end come down on the Senjin.
Even such a weak turn,
yeah,
though.
Even going to tempo in a rage, and just the 2-3 Alexstrasza's champion. I think this is the first time I've ever been sat in this position, looking up at a board, and not had that guy charging in my face.
You know, now Muzzy know that Grommash Hellscream has already been depleted. Dude only can have one of those in his deck, so he doesn't have the ability to burst him with that much damage. His biggest source of damage is the Ragnaros Firelord, so that might give him more freedom to play things like Sylvanas and not be afraid of death.
Yeah, at this point, Muzzy could almost just afford to 2-for-1 himself, you know, on every card that gets played and still come out ahead because of just how much higher quality his remaining cards are. If he just gets all these Death Rattles in the bank and then gets N'Zoth played, the game is more or less over as long as he doesn't die in the meantime. Mm-hmm. As you said, Rag is the only out at this point, so he just needed to make sure that, you know, face, drop Ragnaros, Prey is not an option that can ever kill him. He should be fairly secure from there.
Well, there's a dragon, so that is a pretty decent reload. You can double trade into Sylvanas, as painful as it is.
play Alexstrasza's champion and Azure Drake, start getting aggressive and hope that your opponent doesn't have cards like Reno Jackson or N'Zoth the Corruptor. But at the same time, Reno Warlock is so far ahead in the resource battle. Maybe you don't trade into Sylvanas and you just have to hope that he can't kill you and you just go super aggressive and hope for a Ragnar's finish.
I mean, yeah, how much damage are you pushing? You'd push 8 this turn. It's only putting him down to 9. You still have to find that one extra spot of damage. It's just going to drop the rag here and hope that this Ragnaros can carry. But the Siphon Salt is available. And now, with this Ragnaros taken care of, that is the vast, vast majority of the reach gone. Korkrons are pretty much all that's left in terms of significant damage, as well as just weapons to face.
That's right, and one that already has been used very early on.
Yeah. So Muzzy just considering his options here, I think. I mean, I guess it's a consideration of whether he's life tapping or not, which right. I honestly just don't see the need for. Mm-hmm. Apart from that, Siphon Soul into Doomsayer into drop N'Zoth next turn if you don't, for example, pick up Reno, which you consider even more secure next turn, just looks like a potentially game-winning line at this point.
What can dude really do from here? Maybe if he life taps into both of his chargers. Oh, he didn't even get one. Because yeah. Azure Drake can be played before the Alexstrasza's champion because you already have another dragon in hand. I think you need to do something, like to tap aggressively or to draw a card or do something.
Yeah, he's got to find himself a win condition here, and either way, that involves doing something weird-looking, which is dropping one of your cards into a Doomsayer. So he can either drop an Azure Drake and hope that he hits Korkron number one, and then next turn try and pick up Korkron number two, and then jam them all together for 11 damage to face. That still includes your opponent life-tapping for you to have lethal. Or you can just try and sink the 3 damage from the Alexstrasza's champion here, but you have to try and find yourself a win condition.
I mean, that is something that you can win with Onyxia, but, I mean, now he's going to have to seize back the tempo, kill off that Doomsayer, because if you let that Doomsayer activate, you're not coming back on that board ever.
Nope. So it looks like it is just going to be Azure Drake, champion into the Doomsayer and execute. Does pick up the Fiery War Axe, which is a source of damage. And this does make the N'Zoth turn a little bit scary. There is one taunt in there in the Infested Tauren, but that taunt gets eaten up very quickly and allows any remaining damage to be plowed directly through to your face.
Yeah, that is true. So N'Zoth means that you are vulnerable to Korkron elites to finish the game.
Yep. Double Korkron would, in fact, be lethal if he was to play N'Zoth.
So then perhaps he feels like he wants to Shadow Flame or AoE.
Cold Apothecary, Shadow Flame looks fine. He's going to Demon Wrath here instead, which means he is developing Twilight Drake. Yeah,
and the Cold Apothecary. Okay, yep. That's a very nice halfway play there. I like it. Wait, does it play around Korkron, Double Korkron, and Fiery War Axe?
No, and two of those cards have been picked up. If he life taps, he doesn't have the mana to commit the second Korkron. But this is, he's just fingertips away is dude at booking his seat at the championships. Just doesn't quite have that extra point of damage.
I guess he has to be reliant on either trading or playing a Nixie and hoping opponent doesn't have one single point of damage. One single point of damage, that's all he needs. But he's already used Power Whelming. He's already used a lot of other things too.
There is the Onyxia, there is the Shadow Flame to answer this, but the Hellfire picks up. That will do nicely for Muzzy, who is going to take us all the way to a Game 5 yet again.
That's right, and what better way to determine who can go through with better than just a Game 5 here. We have Muzzy going up against Dude, which is, I believe, Shaman up against Warrior. And this is going to be a little bit scary for Muzzy because this is the deck that Dragon Warrior is the reason why they got popular.
Right.
Was to kill the Shaman decks that Muzzy brought.
Yeah, I mean, Dragon Warrior can just do horrible, sinful things to this deck. Just, you know, Blood to Ichor interacting with Argent Squires, Fiery War Axe for your Tunnel Trog into Blood to Ichor your Totem Golem and take that down too as well. Yep. Alexstrasza's champion charging into your Tunnel Trog. Just the early game just interacts so badly for the aggressive Shaman deck.
Yeah, it tends to. Although one of the things that can happen is also the awkward draw. draws. Dude had it previous game. Where was all of his early game that he really needed? It does happen once in a while. So we can see potential stumble here, allowing Shaman to get onto the board, and all of a sudden it goes the other way.
For Doomhammer.
That is not looking like an awkward opener, though. Dude, in quite possibly the most important game of Hearthstone he has ever played, is staring at the almost perfect 1-2 curve in this situation. He would probably like that Fairy Dragon to be Alexstrasza's champion, but apart from that, can't complain too much.
Yeah. Perhaps Inner Rage could
become... Yeah, the Inner Rage is going. Yeah. As I say, the other two cards, that's ideal in this scenario.
All right, Muzzy does have some plays too. It's not completely decided based off the way the draws have panned out so far.
Dinner's Lost First Mate, though, is going to come down, but Muzzy has the ideal answer to this in the form of Sir Finley, which is the one drop you want to have in this situation. Argent Squire is a miserable feeling when you're dropping it into an Azoth's First Mate. Tunnel Trog, it just feels a little bit too high value to run the risk against this opener as Warrior, but Sir Finley, exactly what you want to try and contest this.
What is the right pick here? Now, I can make an argument. Oh, I mean, Life Tap is the highest value hero.
Yes.
Power is I can definitely make an argument for Shapeshift if you want to control the board a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I do like having board impact hero powers against Dragon Warrior most of the time. Life Tap can get you into a sticky spot where they just start winning the race against you because so many of their cards are actually even more aggressive than yours are. Mm-hmm. So I would be tempted to go with the Shapeshift here. Yeah, I like this pick.
Okay, dude has the Fairy Dragon, which does get challenged just by that hero power, or even worse, the Argent Horse Rider. And that's not the early game that dude was looking for to explode out of the gate.
It's not.
He doesn't even have a play the next turn.
Nope, absolutely not. He needed some help here. Like I said, if that Fairy Dragon was an Alexstrasza's champion, he would have started to tear this game apart. But the coin Argent Horse Rider here is going to start to create a huge fight back here from Muzzy.
Okay, Muzzy hesitating a little bit, thinking about what's the implications of the Totem Golem draw.
He's also considering, I guess, Ravaging Ghoul as an on-curve play for his opponent. If he was to coin Argent Horse Rider into the 3-2 and his opponent were to have Ravaging Ghoul, right, that would essentially just leave him with a full swing with just a 3-3 left on the board facing down nothing. And he doesn't have a nice answer to a 3-3 in his hand right now, so it looks like he's going to play around that scenario and go with Feral Spirits instead.
That is pretty interesting. I guess the nice thing, too, is that he sets up for the Flamewreath Faceless to potentially be a huge swing on the board. And dude whiffs on turn three. And the importance of Dragon Warrior is that it's built so that way it can have these minion plays, with Fierce Monkey even also going into the mix.
Sure.
Frothing Berserkers, Ravaging Ghouls, none of them make an appearance.
This Feral Spirit play, I mean... Yeah, like you said, it opens up his turn four for the Flame Wreath play, but he gives himself nothing to do next turn for a start. This is definitely a scared play. This is a play that he did because he is afraid of Ravaging Ghoul. Mm-hmm. Whether or not, when I use the word scared play, I'm not like belittling the play and saying it's wrong. It's just this is a play he's made with specific answers in mind, and he's deciding that that is too much of a blowout for him. But the inherent downsides of this play are just naturally occurring as well, in that he's just going to have to whiff a turn here. Which means if his opponent had just a strong development here with, you know, Fierce Monkey, Frothing Berserker, any of these on-curve plays, he might find himself just falling behind naturally. But he has run into the hand here that just has nothing to do on turn three.
Execute.
Oh,
wow.
This is huge.
That's so massive. And Muzzy sees that execute, realizing that, you know what? That Flame Wreath Faces is looking pretty pristine right around now.
Rockbiter picked up something he could, in theory, do. He could equip Rockbiter and hit his opponent in the face. That is a legal play, but it's not something he will be considering.
Not for now. And it's a good thing Dude traded his Fairy Dragon, because if he chose to be really scared defensive, hoping that Muzzy would, you know, do the trade for him, then he would have lost that.
Right. Yeah, so Muzzy did just kind of play the game there, I guess, and just wait the adequate amount of time to reflect the fact that he had a decision in his hand. Of course, he didn't, but he doesn't need to reveal that information to his opponent.
And and Doomhammer's picked up. So that is very important, given that he has not just the Rockbiter in hand, but also the Druid Hero Power, which is pretty relevant.
The look on Dude's face, he knows it here. He knows how important this game is. He knows how crucial that decision to use and execute on the previous turn was. And he knows that he just got punished for it.
Well, he did pick up the Blackwing Corruptor, which is an important draw.
I wield the power.
I mean, it's not good enough, though. It still gets contested. The 7-4 into the 3-6 is just fine for Muzzy in this situation.
Yep, and now Muzzy can start playing the removal game as well. Or he can also load up onto the board here. He can also use Rockbiter if he doesn't want to use Lava Burst. Which is actually an interesting thought, because it does free up his mana the following
turn. It allows him to play Doomhammer next turn if he needs to, is the important thing. If he was to Lava Burst this turn, he is not able to Doomhammer on the following turn. And protecting this 7-1 is paramount. Of course, this gets punished by the same thing that he was considering earlier in the form of the Ravaging Ghoul, but at this point, it's not a blowout, because he'll just be able to equip Doomhammer and start generating value that way.
Oh, man. There's the mythical tree drop. He was looking for that fierce monkey turns ago. Where were you, monkey?
Wow. He did get a ping, but it's not the one he would have wanted.
I guess that is... We tried to have the Druid or the Rogue Hero Power in this instance. Maybe the Rogue one.
I mean, Mage is my answer to
right,
that.
Right. If you can't get Mage.
Yeah, exactly.
Because if you had to take the damage, I guess you'd rather have the weapon set up.
Sure. Yeah, Doomhammer suddenly not looking too rosy. He'd have to double face tank a 3-4, and that would be all he achieved on this turn. So having now drawn the Tuskar Totemic, it looks like just the development to fight on the board with the high-quality minions, Tuskar Totemic and Totem Golem, just looks a little bit more promising. Might even decide to Tuskar and Lava Burst the 3-4, honestly. That's not a bad-looking play either.
Both players look extremely stressed.
Yes.
They've realized how close they are to the finish line, both touching their hair more than they're touching their cards. And the basic totem comes out.
Here's a healing totem, and now with no 1-1 being generated here, no totem golem, no huge value, that 3-4 just gets, that 3-4 just eats up the 3-2 here, so. Interesting that he does decide to not go for the Lava Burst line here. He's going to concede the board fully on this turn now. That is almost guaranteed to happen.
Yeah, I get it. He wants to play Doomhammer and Hero Power next turn to be able to clear some of the board up. So he's just playing Argent Horseshoe because he needs to get down to the board. He, of course, rather play Totem Golem, which is stronger in stats. But he can't really afford to do that. And now, dude, starting to pick up some of his very reasonable mid-game. Dadadrake allows him to squeeze in the Hero Power. Ravaging Ghoul, not a bad card to have in their back pocket for later on. And dude's got some really big dudes coming up.
Dude has some big dudes. The name is fitting. And wow, this trade, the respect for the aggression of the Shaman here, even with his taunt minion, he's gonna choose to trade.
Oh, the Storm!
Is it the time to play the Storm?
I'm not. Sure, it's so close.
If you play Doomhammer, you're stuck playing Totem Golem into a 4-4 minion.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess what it does do is it encourages the trade from the Azure Drake.
And then allows you to possibly set up a Storm on the following turn with the Drake as a 4-1, so... Yeah, he's just going to decide that this 1-1 is not relevant with double Lava Burst in hand and that Druid Hero Power doing 2 damage a turn now with Doomhammer equipped. I actually like this decision a lot.
Wow. Does that change anything? The Blackwing Corruptor?
I think you're always Gromming this turn.
Okay.
I just don't see another decision. You have to make your Shaman opponent respect your board and start playing defensively. If you just try and wait this game out and play card for card, that Doomhammer is going to race you down.
That does put Grom at a very inconvenient 6 health.
Yeah.
So I do think that puts Dude at a pretty significant advantage at this point. And I think Dude should go for it.
Dude is considering his options, though. Like you said, the Corruptor does look appealing with the fight with the 3 damage battle cry plus the 1-1 into the 3-4. Does look nice, allows him to squeeze in that 1 extra life from the Hero Power, which he might consider relevant, but I think this is always the correct line. He has to set up a win for himself here, which he is doing on the board. Damage push to face now means that he is representing lethal. Muzzy has to find himself a way out. Muzzy only looking at 16 damage right now.
Dude puts the damage in and just praying that he can't answer.
Can't even do the 16, doesn't have the mana. He is a long way off.
Okay, now Muzzy's trying to calculate what he can do the following turn if he puts 4 into his opponent this turn. Then what happens? He probably ends up thinking about setting up Thing from Below just to buy him time. Lava Burst needs to go aggressive. So if he does 4 this turn, you can do 14 the following, or sorry, 16 the next turn.
Yep.
And I think that's what he has to set up for his best case scenario. And according to this, he would be dead just by one health point.
I wonder.
Because there's the Blackwing Corruptor and the Hero Power, and that'd be 14. Is that it?
It's looking like it, yeah. I mean, can he do anything here to change the maths in terms of trading with Finley? I don't think it matters, right? If Drake was just to come down,
then he would just Ravaging
Ghoul, Blackwing Corruptor, the face, and Hero Power. That's 10 mana, though. That's 10 mana.
No, I think that's it.
And the fact that he's gone face, that is now 100% over.
Yeah, that's it. So, dude has booked his ticket to the championship. He's gonna make this trade, but he's been able to see it, and that Blackwing Corruptor is gonna book him a ticket to the championships in the top 8.
What a huge performance from Dude. You can see on both of these players' face how high the emotions were running during these games. Both players appreciating the stakes at hand, and Dude just looks overwhelmed with the scenario. Close to tears, in fact. This is how much it means to these players who have worked all year long to get to this point.
That was grueling. I'm tired just looking at it. I'm not saying that in mockery. I'm actually just out of a lot of respect and admiration. These guys have played for hours, and it's been long days, grueling matches, and intense. He took down the number one player in points, and Muzzy came so close as well. You do have to wonder all the what-ifs, but at the end of the day, you have to also say congratulations. Dude did a great job, and he also had a very tough run in his first series of the day where he got stopped at the door at Game 5. That would have been soul-crushing to be stopped once again.
Yeah, and I think something else that needs to be pointed out is we just watched a very high-level series of Hearthstone as well. Like, honestly, that was a very well-played series from both sides, and two great players, either of which would have done the America's Championship proud, but it is going to be Dude who makes it through. Muzzy, like I said, is just going to have to pack it all up, compose himself, get ready for that last call.
We'll see him a month after that. But for now, the moment belongs to Dude, who is the sixth player to get his ticket to the championship. We have two more matches after this, and a couple of players that are notable as well that people have been paying attention to see how far they can go. I personally want to see if Hot Meowth can continue his streak next series as well. But for now, we're going to head over to TJ for an interview with our sixth contestant for the America's Championship.
Thanks very much, guys. I have to agree with Sada, one of the highest level matches I've watched in a long time. I couldn't even watch at the end because I was so nervous for both players. Very crucial games and very crucial draws. But I am joined by Dude, the winner from that last match. Hey, man, can you hear me?
Yeah, TJ.
Hey, first off, as someone who's been sort of following your path for a long time, how does it feel for that hard work to finally pay off?
It feels really, really good. I don't know if there's any other way I can describe it. Just good, man.
Yeah, I could see the emotion crossing your face after you won that match, an intense series, and especially after that brutal series early on. How did you feel after your loss in the first match of the day that you had to play?
I was pretty salty, but I've been losing all month to Yogg, so it's nothing new. I'm used to it. And I did misplay a few times, I think, so could be worse.
Yeah, you got it done in the end. And I'm going to ask you a question now that I think is on a lot of people's minds. What does the 7597 stand for?
It's my birthday, July 5th, 1997.
Okay. That was a theory that a lot of people had here. Talk to me a little bit through your lineup. You sort of brought a little bit more of a standard lineup because you included like the Dragon War and things like that. But you also decided to add Freeze Mage. So talk to me a little bit about your strategy coming into the preliminary and how it performed according to your expectations.
Yeah, so I didn't have that much time to really formulate a lineup because I had a Frisbee tournament out of state all weekend. So basically, I just got back on Monday, and I actually ran all my decks by Muzzy. I was like, Muzzy, are these the right techs? Like, is Double Crazed Alchemist good? And he was like, yeah, it looks pretty good. And I also wanted to take decks like that were pretty easy to play for the most part, because I went, except for Freeze Mage, which is obviously pretty hard to play, but I've been playing it for a long time, so I feel like it's kind of a comfort pick for me.
Yeah, there was actually some really close games with Freeze Mage that I was actually surprised that he pulled out, so I was really impressed overall. But last question, man, before I let you go celebrate, do you have anybody that you'd like to give special thanks to, or any shout-outs that you'd like to give to people that helped you practice?
Yeah, there are a ton of people. I probably did like 8 or 9 best of fives before the tournament. But I know I'm going to forget people, but everyone in the Digital Athletics Skype group, especially like Knoblore and Super Sam. Astrogation, too, has been like a huge influence on me. I played him in an open tournament once, and he didn't delete me, which is pretty nice. And we got to know each other a little better, and he's really helped me become the player that I am now. Also, huge thanks to Laughing. I played with him quite a bit over the past few weeks. And he helped me a lot with my Freeze Mage play.
It wouldn't be complete without some thanks to Laughing after some Freeze Mage play, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, thanks. Again, I'll let you go celebrate. And big congratulations. I look forward to meeting you and getting to see you play at the championship.
All right. Thanks, DJ.
Thanks.